and we've gathered together in this kind of displaced space. I don't know if you've noticed, but when I'm leading worship, although I've moved down from the pulpit down to the front section, I don't move all around all that much. I'm not a minister who walks around the aisles and preach. I've got my little space that I'm pretty comfortable in, as much as I can be comfortable in front of everyone leading worship. Today, it's a little bit of a displaced space, standing here in a different way. I know some of you are feeling that way too, because many of us have our space, a place where we feel comfortable at home, where we feel rooted as we worship together. But we're gathered in this displaced space, for a very intentional reason. We're reliving something that happened 93 years ago, when people gathered for worship and then work as they began the United Church. It was a displaced space because they had to gather in a hockey arena. I'm sure many of those people would have loved to have been in a church that Wednesday at 10:30 a.m. as they worship, but there was no church leaving them. They were also in a displaced space because they were beginning something new through God's leading. They were becoming a new denomination, carrying with them their traditions and letting go of others. And our moderator pointed out this past week, was at Hamilton Conference, that there was a displacement for some people too, because in voting in favor of union, in taking part in that first general council, they were going back to the church, some of them, to help close their buildings so they could join another church. And those who weren't were at least going back to help make their church into a new denomination. It was a bit of a displaced space as they not just turned a page, not just ended one chapter and begin another. It was more like ending one volume to begin. So we're stepping into that displaced space by gathering here in the shape of a hockey arena. Space where we can see one another as well. We're gathered in this displaced space to hopefully, like those 8,000 people, like those 340-some delegates, our commissioners, to step into that displaced space to find where Christ is leading us, and to experience where God is calling us to create a new something by coming together. It is a blessing to be together, to worship God together. And it is a huge joy to be back with you on a Sunday. If you've been around the last month, you may have been wondering where I've been. I've been here and there and everywhere. I was away, as many of you know, because I was back a Sunday after, away for a week with my wife at Disney World, having a wonderful holiday. Everything kind of piled up in 1 month. Nothing happened really since last August, and all of a sudden, I was away. I came back for a week on Sunday, and then I was away for a wonderful continuing education week, taking courses on conflict and conflict management and leadership through conflict. Great courses at Conrad Grebel University. Then I was back for half a week, and then I had wisdom teeth out involved with an hour and a half surgery and being put under. For a weekend, was knocked off my feet. And then I was back for most of the week. And then I was away at Hamilton Conference, which was a wonderful meeting over at Port Elgin. Hamilton Conference became officially an affirming conference at that meeting. We also had the moderator and general secretary of the United Church with us, which was amazing to hear. The moderator shared stories across the church. We also marked that with changes to church structure that will be voted on this summer, that was most likely the last time Hamilton Conference would gather together, which was very touching to me because I was ordained 11 years ago at the conference. And now I'm back, which is wonderful. It's wonderful to see all of you again and share in worship. If you look in your bulletin, you'll see our announcements for this week. I'll highlight a couple of them. Please note that we are looking for some ushers for June 10th and June 24th. Tent's covered now. July needs quite a bit. Adam has a sign-up sheet that he's put on the table back there. So please sign in if you'd like to usher. It's a wonderful way of welcoming people into worship and helping people feel comfortable and at home here. Thank you to everyone who volunteers to usher. We keep in our prayers St. James Rosemount, United Church in Kitchener, part of the Waterloo Presbytery. We have a lot of work going into our 160th anniversary celebration this fall. One of the things we're looking for is pictures. Many of us had pictures taken for our photo directory, but if you didn't and would like to submit a photo, please see Lynn Hepburn and Joyce Yardby as soon as possible, because we'd like to add your picture to a special project that is happening. A great big thank you to everyone who helped me worship while I've been away on holidays and studying work. And a big thank you on behalf of the Canadian Food Grants Bank. Last week we raised $1,495. And as you heard last week, wonderful ministry happening through the Canadian Food Grants Bank. Please know that today is Decoration Sunday at the Hanover Cemetery. It will be at 2 p.m. Please bring a lawn chair. And I don't know if it's raining yet, but if it does rain, the service will be held in the chapel, and we are all welcome to take part in it. A music recital is happening this afternoon, so if you want to hear some more great music at 7 p.m. tonight, students of Sally Corbin and Yuki, Jordan and Doug are going to be playing in piano, voice, and guitar. We had our first study of the Transfiguration, Transcending Gender in the Bible. We had 8 people out. It was a really good time of conversation study. If you missed this week, that's okay, but we'd love to see you next week. 8:30 is early, but we'll have the coffee on to help wake you up. We have snacks. And if you need to come in your pajamas and then go home and change, that's okay too. Or your curlers, we won't judge. This Thursday is Election Day in Ontario. We keep in prayer those who are voting, those who are running. And there will be a polling station here at the church, and they are still looking for some volunteers for that. I guess not volunteers, because there are paid positions. So they're looking for helpers for that. Fish fry. Do you mind asking fish fry? Perfect.
Your generous and thoughtful donations will be used to enhance our ministry. With within the areas of influence that is in ours through our food bank. Without friends like you, you who are willing to support the Salvation Army in Hanover, we would not be able to reach out and serve others in the manner that we will be able to during these past months. Thank you for helping us to give hope to others. Blessing, Sterling Snellgrove. And also, I just wanted to say thank you to everybody that helped at our trunk sale. We raised over $1,400. Probably heard that last week. Everything else that was left over was donated either to the Salvation Army or Value Village. So nothing goes to landfill. So I think as part of an outreach of this church, we are doing a great job of recycling. So I want to thank everybody for that.
Are there any other celebrations, sorrows, or announcements people would like to share? Doug even told me that he had an announcement too.
There are a lot of changes around here in 12 years, and so I should really introduce myself to some of the faces and folks that I don't know. I'm Reverend Doug Kaufman. You can see me in my photo in the entranceway. This church hangs ministers. Just to share a bit of personal good news. Much to my utter amazement and embarrassment, tomorrow evening I'm being named Senior Citizen, Hanover Senior Citizen of the Year. I'm told the barrel is small and they had to scrape the bottom. There are lots of people in my age range who contribute far more to this community than I do. However, along that line, I want to say that I am writing for Habitat for Humanity again this year on June the 22nd, and I would be glad to relieve you of some of your treasure. And I have a sponsorship here, and so your captive audience, Habitat for Humanity would appreciate assistance. The ride's 85 kilometers from the Restore in Rowan Sound to Wyarton, over to Lake Huron, down to Salt Beach, and back to the store. And last year it was about the same size length. The team raised over $10,500, and each year it goes up. Just a word about Habitat for Humanity Great Roots. It is the longest running, continuous running affiliate of Habitat for Humanity in Canada. And last year, they really pioneered an effort in that they built, we call it Cape Croker. The folks there prefer Neyashinaming. First Nation. They built one home there. And of course you can understand, you know, when cultures are starting to meet, folks wonder. The build was so successful that Habitat for Humanity is now engaged in a multi-year, multi-build project there on the Cape. This year they're building four homes. They were so impressed with quality, the way it's done. And so, you know, while in our communities we sometimes are askance at Habitat building something close to us, the quality of the homes is superior to most of the builds, commercial builds that occur. So it's a wonderful charity. The other thing is, in particular to Great Roots, we run three restores, Hanover, Southampton, and Owen Sound. And all staff salaries are paid out of the returns from these restores. So everything that you contribute to the ride goes directly to the bill. It is next to the Mission and Service Fund of the United Church of Canada. I think it is one of the most efficient charities operating. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Doug. We'll hope that it rain on you this year as you arrive. Are there any other celebrations, sorrows, or announcements? We give thanks to God for all the blessings in our life, the strength that meets us in difficult times, the love of community which inspires us to serve our world. We remember that as we gather for worship here, we are gathered on the traditional territory of the Saugeen and Ojibwe Nation and the Saugeen Métis people. And we pray that God continue to lead us in building right relationship. I invite you to join with me in our mission statement that's found in the bulletin. As those who share in the life of this church, we strive to live out our mission. Grace United Church is a diverse Christian community, called by God to live out the love shown by Jesus Christ. And we join with what people sang for many years as the traditional opening hymn for worship here in many churches, Holy, 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 verse 1. Let us ignite our Christ fire. May the fire of Christ burn brightly in our lives and all around us. And remember that for many, many years, throughout time, people gathered around a fire to share stories of life and the sacred stories which offer us meaning and advice to explore our depths. A reading from Genesis chapter 1, verses 1. When God began to create the heavens and the earth was without shape or form. It was dark over the deep sea, and God's wind swept over the water. God said, "Let there be light." And so light appeared. God saw how good the light was. God separated the light from the darkness. And God named the light day and the darkness night. There was evening, and there was morning, the first day. God made dry land.
God separated the dry land from the water, and on the dry land he made the green things that grow. And God looked at the dry land and the green growing things, and God said, "It is good." And that was the end of the third day. On the fourth day, God made day and God made night. God separated the day from the night and gave us a bright light in the day to rule over the day, and this bright light is the sun. God gave us the bright lights of the moon and the stars at night to rule over the night. And God looked at the day and the night, our way of telling time, and God said, "It is good." And that was the end of the fourth day. On the fifth day, God created the creatures of the sky. Not just the birds, but all of the creatures that fly in our sky. And then God created all of the creatures that swim in the waters. All of them. And God looked at the creatures of the air and the creatures of the water, and God said, "It is good." And that was the end of the fifth day. On the sixth day, God created the creatures that walk on the ground. God created the creatures with two legs and the creatures with many legs. And God looked at the creatures that walk on the ground, and God said, "It is good." And that was the end of the sixth day. On the seventh day, God rested. God looked back over the 6 days, and God felt, "This is good. This is a day of rest." And on this day, God asks that we remember all of these 6 days in whatever way that speaks to us. Perhaps we remember this day in church. Perhaps we remember it while out on a walk in the woods or sitting at the waterside. However we remember that day, that's for us. Some people, Christians, feel this day is so special they mark it with a cross, and Jewish people mark it with the Star of David. These are the 7 days of creation, and they are good. Now I wonder which of these days is your favorite. Which of these days is your day? Which day is especially made just for you? Day 4. Day 3. all created by God from nothing but a smile.
And a stick-slapping puck of skates on ice, of the echoing play-by-play of an announcer. Yet in Mutual Street Arena on Wednesday, June 10, 1925 at 10:30 a.m., there was a new sound. A quarter of a century of planning, dreaming, hard work, which was delayed by the first before, was paying off. As the Toronto Symphony Orchestra began to play, and a 250-member choir led the congregation in song, a congregation of 8,000 people. The church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is his new creation. And when worship had ended after communion had been served, the words were shared. I hereby declare that the Presbyterian Church in Canada, the Congregational Churches of Canada, and the Methodist Church Canada, along with the General Council of Local Union Churches, are now united and constituted as one church to be designated as the United Church of Canada. The first General Council meeting of the United Church. It was the first time in the world when denominations would cross their historic boundaries. I mean, it was the first time that Methodists didn't join just with Methodists or Presbyterians with Presbyterians. It would inspire other denominations later on throughout the world to join together. But it all started after so many years of holding on to a dream and working towards a day when people of different denominations chose to be in relationship together and to co-create with God a new kind of denomination. The first creation story, which Sonia has just led us into, the story of Genesis, the breath, word, spirit of God blows over, here's a Hebrew word for you, the tohu mavohu, a chaotic, formless mess, bringing about creation. In the story, God has to choose relationship with creation over the chaos to unleash that first spark of light, that first big bang of the universe's expansion. The story is intimate because words are always intimate. Word is spoken, creation happens, and celebration is shared. Choosing relationship, the story goes, God's Spirit hovers over the chaos, bringing about a new creation. And the stories of our faith say again and again that the story doesn't end with one act of creation, but that God is always creating, and God is always calling us to be co-creators. Oh, good old hockey game. There was no sound of stick, no skates on ice, no echoing play-by-play by an announcer. But a hymn was sung out as people stood from their chairs and bleachers and sang with a holy passion, trusting that God was calling them to help co-create something new. So let us join in their song, the Church's One Foundation.
Thank you.
was telling that story to people another day. But as we listen to Mark chapter 4, yeah, we hear God speaking to us. That day when evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let's go over to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him along, just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with them. A furious squall came up, and the wave broke over the boat, so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you care or not be afraid?" He got up and rebuked the wind and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down and it was completely calm. Jesus said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" And they were terrified and they asked each other, "Who is this that even the wind obeys?" God bless the period of these holy words. If our United Church was a member of this congregation, well, a couple times a year, Sally would send it an invitation to the nifty 90s party at Craven's. And we'd gather with our church to share in coffee, tea, and juice, muffins, cookies. We gather for the nifty 90s celebration. And as we gather, we'd share our stories and hear what amazing things happened in over 90 years. We'd listen and we'd hear what amazing things happened in 93 years. Our dear United Church would tell the stories of their feisty self, one who dared to make bold steps, even when it meant that, well, others shaked their heads and thought them reckless. In 1925, our dear 93-year-old church would say, "Well, I ordained Lydia Grucci, and no other denomination in Canada was ordaining women at the time. And some were upset, and yes, some left the church." It wasn't all that great, though. Our church would continue. It would take me another 32 years to realize that, yes, of course, married women could continue their ministry, because, of course, a woman can be a wife and a mother and a minister. Again, some were upset, and some left. And our dear 93-year-old would continue with excitement. Well, in 1988, I would live that same boldness once more as I declared that sexual orientation would not be a barrier to full participation and membership in the church, including ministry. Again, very few other churches were doing this, and it would be generations before some would even have the conversation. "I'm still feisty as ever," our dear church would say. "I'm continuing to work at faithfully following in the path of Christ by seeing the beauty and worth of all people in current work and racism and ableism, and to build right relations and to learn and grow in our understanding and appreciation for God's holy gift that is found in each person and that is discovered in diversity." And our dear 93-year-old church would smile, holding their cup of tea, and say, "You know, sometimes to follow Christ, we have to make daring decisions and take bold actions and sail through that storm." And our dear 93-year-old's eyes would light up as they brush their hair back, take a sip of coffee, and talk about the wild dreams of youth. That there would one day be one Protestant denomination in all of Canada, and about the great conversations it's led to, and the realization, well, that different denominations were okay, but we could work alongside one another through local ministerials, the Canadian Council of Churches, the World Council of Churches, and justice initiatives like the Canadian Food Grains Bank, Kairos, and global partnerships through mission service. We dream big, our dear 93-year-old would say to us as we place another cookie on our napkin and listen. We dream big, and often the risk led to beautiful things. Sometimes we dream big, and we were a little arrogant and destructive, as we'd all be in our youth. And tears begin to fill our 93-year-old's eyes. Through tears, our 93-year-old continues, we once thought that we had the only truth that mattered. We join in the great painful act of our country, helping to run residential schools into the 90s, talking about how God was working through us as children were forced from their homes and from their cultures, as we helped to silence language and support the banning of religious ceremony. We couldn't see, didn't want to see, and made sure we didn't see the great suffering that comes whenever we talk and we don't listen. And so, our 93-year-old continues, we cried as we stood around the sacred fire in Sudbury and took up the wisdom of Alberta Billy, offering an apology and beginning to work at healing and right relationships that in many ways is only beginning. And yes, there were some that thought we were mad. We would bankrupt the church, some cried. We would be disloyal to those who went before, others yelled. And others just screamed. No other church had taken these bold steps. And later, when a second apology was made in the 90s, naming residential school, we cried again. And our 93-year-old would smile with the wisdom that comes with age and learning. Sometimes when Christ is leading us through the storm, we realize the storm is of our own making. And the work of sailing is difficult, but the destination is holy. And the stories would continue as the coffee cups were empty, the teacups were empty. As our feisty denomination would share the many stories that come with 93 years of life, and there wouldn't be enough time to share all the stories. There'd be tears and laughter and the realization that, well, a lot of life can happen in 93 years, and a lot of changes come in 93 years, and changes always come, but life continues. And as the time together comes to an end, as we finish those last bites of cookie, finish the last drop of our drink, as we get up from the table and make our way out to the parking lot, our 93-year-old church would smile at us and say, well, my dears, the day is still young, and Jesus is still calling. Let's go sailing once more. Let's go see what amazing things we can create with God today. As you were coming in, and as the strips of cloth were handed to you, I heard a lot of you say, what's this for? And I hadn't told the people welcoming what they were for, so it was a cool thing. All right, you'll see. Some of you made them into wonderful scarves. I don't see anyone with any belt made of them, but some of you draped them over different places. I invite you to take, I got this really long one somehow. I invite you to take your cloth in your hand. We're going to share in prayer together. And after the service is done, we'll store. Sally's going to get people who can't be here, who are housebound, to add their own pieces to it. And then we're going to figure a way to make it into a piece of art. So anybody who's crafty. Try to hold your clock. Prayer is so much more than just words. We have strips of cloth. Let us hold them in our hand, feeling the texture, looking at the color. Even a white piece of cloth has variation. Each of these ragged pieces of cloth are different. each have a different history, a different story to tell, just like us. And they're making there the work, the unique work, of an individual, just like us. Cloth can be used as a bandage to protect an injury, or a rag to wipe a sweaty, fevered brow. The raw material of a book or a piece of currency to fasten something which should not be loose. As you hold your cloth in your hand, pause for a moment in its quietness as you feel the texture in your hand. Pass your prayers onto and into. Thinking about the events happening in the world, war, conflict, famine, inequality, oppression, and injustice, quietly tie a knot into your strip of cloth as you call to mind and remember. Think about the places you are from, your home, your family, your school, your workplace, your community. Quietly tie a knot into your strip of cloth as you call them to mind and remember them. Think about those who are sick. Think about those we love but we can see no longer. Quietly tie a knot into your strip of cloth as you call them to mind and remember them. Think about those things we have to be thankful for, the many blessings poured out upon us, the people who surround us, who make a difference in our lives. Think about how we make a difference in the lives of others. Quietly tie a knot into your strip of cloth as you call them to mind and remember them. We do not pray alone, and our knotted cloths are joined with all those past, present, and future. Now tie your cloth to another. Tie those cloths to those around you, and quietly, yet quickly, let us join a chain of prayer linked across this whole sacred place, individual, yet joined. Decisions to be made and a lot of discernment about where we go as a church. We'll be voting on whether or not to bring about a new model of being our church by going to a three-court model instead of four, and about how we should fund this new church, the church now. The hope is that by creating something more nimble, we can live out our mission again and continue to live out our mission. We'll be reviewing and voting on a report entitled Calls to the Church, created by the caretakers of our Indigenous Circle, a group of Indigenous leaders from across the church which strives to create a new relationship based on self-determination and right relationship among the Indigenous and non-Indigenous communities of faith. As our moderator pointed out, the amazing thing is that even after the very difficult history we've shared, First Nations Indigenous communities still want to be part of the church, but in a new way. We'll be exploring membership and disaster assistance strategies and ministry and social justice initiatives, relationships, interfaith relationships, and many more denominationally shaping matters. The story of the church is still being written. It's written for each one of us as we continue to choose relationship to be church together. It is written when we dare to believe that God is still creating beautiful things in this world and calling us to be co-creators of a world of love, peace, and justice. The story continues. Whenever we dare to jump in the same boat with the disciples, with an arena-sized crowd singing the church's one foundation, with the prophets of the church past and present who speak the difficult and important words of God's wisdom, calling us to honest people, calling us to better things. It continues to be written whenever we see that we as Grace United Church and as individual members of it are part of a bigger body, the United Church of Canada, Christ's body, universal body. This history of bold action, tears and lamentation, of works towards healing and justice, and strive to faithfully live in response to Christ's call and God's continuous act of creation, is part of our history, and it is our calling. The story continues to be written because God continues to be at work in our lives and in our church. Friends, to move from this place and share a meal together. Let us feel the Spirit drawing our lives together and leading us to be co-creators with God. Let us jump in the boat with Christ and continue in the bold discipleship. For we are all part of the holy story that God is ever writing in this world. May God bless our people.